I've paid my dues time after time. I've done my sentence but committed no crime. And bad mistakes I've made a few. I've had my shells and kicked in my
Welcome to the Half Empty, Half Full radio show on the Tan Talk Radio Network with your host, Laurie Zoock, the consumer champion. So listen up every Thursday night from 11 p.m. to midnight and learn something new. All opinions are that of the hosts and guests. Have a story idea? Contact us through Facebook on Half Empty, Half Full. We want to hear from you. And now, here's your host, the consumer champion, Laurie Zoock.
Welcome to the Half Empty, Half Full Talk Radio Show on the 1340 AM Tan Talk Network. I'm your host, Laurie Zoock, and each week we'll be discussing problems and solutions, changing negatives to positives, and helping you, the consumer, to get smarter faster. Today we'll be discussing real estate investments. And if you're looking to make money in real estate investments, and you need to find an investor or a realtor that can help you and not hurt you, then you need to listen to this show. There are plenty of legitimate investors that are also licensed realtors, and there are also investors and realtors that are shady and perform fraudulent or unethical transactions. You, the consumer, might not be educated enough to know that you're being taken for a ride in a risky investment. Now, on last week's show, we discussed appraisal fraud. Today, you're going to want to stay tuned so you can learn the proper way to invest, how to find a good mentor, and what you can do if you've been defrauded. And my guest today is Jim Velazquez, and he's a man of many hats. Welcome to the show, Jim. You've done real estate, marketing, investments. Give me some of your background here. You've done a lot of things.
Yes. My background, I'll start a little bit from where I first started.
Okay.
Five brothers, five sisters, huge family. So we had to work pretty hard to get to you know, where we wanted, okay?
Competition in your own family.
A little bit, just a little bit. But anyway, long story short, mom, dad got a divorce, moved to Florida. I was a youngster when that happened. My first experience was working for a friend of the family. I would say my first real job. I was 15 years old. Ran his concrete company. He used to sell sand and do all different kind of things. So that was my first little bug into entrepreneurialism. It was pretty exciting for me at that young of an age.
Okay.
Moving forward, bought my first house. I was 19 years old. Bought the house for $80,000, sold it for $120,000. That's $40,000.
Wow.
Now I'm going to date myself. That's 1979.
Oh, my gosh. So you were a teenager.
I was 19. So that was a long time ago, okay? But, man, that was it. I was hooked. I was hooked on real estate at that point in time. I mean, that's a lot of money to make.
Right.
You know, on one deal in 1979.
More than some people probably made in a year.
In a year. Oh, absolutely. At that point in time, I was doing my own entrepreneurialism as well. I had a landscape business and some other things. I've always had that that spirit, you know, of entrepreneur. But again, long story short, licensed as a real estate broker in 1989. So I'm a Florida licensed real estate broker, have been for a lot of years. Also was a licensed correspondent mortgage lender for a long time. And then also partnered in a title company. So I really have a broad base of experience in the real estate business. But what got my real estate business going was marketing. So,
Okay. You
know, marketing kind of became like my focus to keep the real estate going. So as I just said to your friend out of the studio here, you know, we really don't sell real estate anymore. We market, and then the business
comes
happens.
In that way.
So
right.
That's kind of a little synopsis of my background. I don't know.
Right. Well, you have a marketing company also.
I do. I have a marketing company called GoMobileGreen.com. And it really has a big emphasis and a big focus on social media. and combining that with the mobile platform, which is really huge right now. I mean, that's where everything is going. 92% of us, people like you and me, have their cell phones with them all the time.
Can't live without your cell phone. You know? Lose it, you're in a panic, right? That's exactly. Why I have two, so I can find call the other one number if I can't find it, you know?
I love it when we connected. Yeah, you told me that story.
Right.
Hilarious.
And now, you also are a real estate investment coach, correct?
Correct.
You mentor and help people, and that's one of the reasons I wanted to do the show.
Oh,
was because you're very reputable, and I know that you're very reputable.
Thank
but
you.
There's a lot of people that aren't. So we're going to talk dirt first.
Okay.
And I want to talk about dirty deals, because over the years, you know, I'm a credit consultant, so mm-hmm. I hear all these stories. And I've heard a lot of stories about consumers that have been taken advantage of in real estate investing by unethical investors. Now, just because it's unethical does not mean it's illegal.
Right.
It might be immoral. It might be unethical. It might not be illegal, but some of them were. Can you give me a few stories?
Oh, boy, that's a good question. Personally, you know, I've not.
Well, things you've heard.
You know, things I hear. I mean, you hear all the time. You know, the first thing that comes to my mind is like the Bernie Madoff kind of people that are out there just, you know, straight out to scam somebody.
Right.
You know, they're not. It's not, you know, the unethical thing. It's just they're just out there, you know, to get somebody. You know, a recent thing that I heard of was Craigslist. I mean, people are posting houses they don't even own on Craigslist. You know, they're either renting them or trying to sell them, and they don't own them. So that's been
there was a fellow, I think, in the last couple of years, I want to say up in Pasco County, wasn't he? He was renting out people's homes that didn't belong to him?
Right.
Something to that effect.
People that had moved
out,
people that had vacated the property.
Yeah, and it was squatter's rights, he claimed.
That's what he was claiming. He didn't pull it off. I mean, he ended up in a lot of legal trouble
or prison.
He did, you know, he collected a lot of money for a long time. But, you know, that's the unethical approach.
Right.
I mean, the guy was trying to scam people.
Well,
basically.
I'd be nervous about anything on Craigslist, because a lot of times they ask for your personal information,
right.
You know, your social security, and they don't even list their name, company, or contact number. Now, a realtor I know has to list their company name, their contact information, and usually some type of a disclaimer. But an investor doesn't. So I think you have to be warned and be really cautious, because Craigslist mm-hmm. actually has a section on scams and frauds that you can read. But people sometimes are desperate and they want to buy, you know, a cheap house, and they think they're going to get a great deal, and it's going to backfire on them, and it's going to end up hurting them. So, you know, one of the things I've heard a lot about when it comes to real estate investments are trusts and LLCs. You know, and I've heard stories where, you know, the realtor or the investor person will have maybe the house is in foreclosure and they're signing the deed over to that person, but now they're liable on the mortgage. So it's not so much an investment. Maybe they're in trouble on their own home. What do you know about that?
A couple of different things you touched on.
I throw everything
there,
at once.
There's a couple of different kind of trusts that are pretty prominent. One of them is a land trust. That has a very specific use, and there's absolutely nothing, you know, wrong with those. Those are good if they're used properly.
Right.
I just had an idea, so I'm going to say it. What might be a good thing is to post a link, because folks, I'm not a licensed real estate attorney or an accountant.
The disclaimer.
You're not
giving legal advice.
Right,
we're having a general educational conversation.
Right, exactly.
Here on the show.
So, but what I thought would be a good thing, especially on this topic, because it's kind of intricate, and you know, I use land trust. It's a good tool.
What is it? What is a land trust?
Well, a land trust basically is an instrument that you can use many different ways. One is kind of like a finance instrument. In other words, if an individual seller has a property that has a mortgage on it still, then you can create a land trust, and the beneficiary of that land trust would be whomever you want that person to be. And the property would be put in that trust. So that is one way that it is used to circumvent what is called the due on sale clause. It's article number 17 in every mortgage. Uh, and And so do banks really want to accelerate that? No, they don't. They want their payment. So really, it doesn't matter to them. But the land trust is used as
like a protection mechanism,
like a protection mechanism. So you can make like an owner finance type deal with somebody that still has a loan on their house.
OK,
there are some caveats that go into that. So I don't know how deep you want to get, but
I think just general for now. But what other types of real estate trusts are there?
Well, real estate trusts, a big one is a lot of people are into is the REITs, you know, the real estate investment trust, which is basically that's a little bit different. That's more like a stock. That's larger funds purchase big pools of real estate or commercial real estate, and then they sell it to people like you and me that can buy a share of that trust.
I gotcha.
The one thing I will say about that is the returns are pretty low on those.
Okay.
And some of these REITs don't allow you to resell your shares for a specific period of time. So if you you got to hold it. So if you put your money into it, then you may have to hold it for a little while, depending on what that agreement is.
All right.
With
now,
that particular trust.
Somebody wants to buy a property, they can do it through a self-directed IRA, correct?
Absolutely.
And is that a good way?
That's one of my favorite ways. For both parties, the investor and the person that is using their IRA funds to fund the deal.
So how does that work? I go to a place that does self-directed IRAs and I open an account. Is there a limitation on how much I can put into it per year?
Yes. Just like,
a regular IRA.
Yeah. If you're starting from scratch, you have a third party administrator. That's what you need to have in order to do a self-directed IRA. So let's say you have an IRA already set up and you have $100,000 in there. So you can do a kind of like a rollover, for lack of a better term. You can take, $50,000 of that money and put it in a self-directed IRA through a third party administrator. No tax consequence or penalty to you for doing that.
Okay.
Because you're not taking the money. You're putting it in another like kind trust.
Okay.
So now you control that $50,000. Okay.
I gotcha.
You're able to, do varying types of investments with that $50,000. So let's say that I came to you and I said, Laurie, I have this really great deal on a piece of real estate. I need $35,000 to acquire that piece of property. Well, Laurie, you could now direct $35,000 of your $50,000 self-directed IRA that is probably earning you a paltry sum in your existing IRA investment account,
right?
So now you can become more or less the bank for that individual. And your IRA would reap the benefits of that return, plus it would be tax-free.
All right, well, stay with us. We're going to come back in just a moment.
Hello, I'm Jim Velazquez. Does getting a lousy 1% on your CDs make you sick to your stomach? Inflation is hovering at 3%, so what's really happening? Allow me, Jim Velazquez, to send you my free report. If you haven't reviewed your CDs in a while, don't get this report. It will break your heart. If you want to fight back and beat the bank, text RETIRE to 72727 for this free report. Let's beat the bank. Text RETIRE to 72727 for your free report.
Do you suffer from back, neck, or body pain? Do you suffer from migraines or have jaw or face pain? Has conventional medicine failed you? Were you injured or in an accident? Call chiropractic physician Dr. Dan Maddock at 813-935-1664. Dr. Dan has helped thousands of patients gain relief for more than 30 years. Dr. Dan is caring, gentle, and takes his time with each patient. He's also a past president of the International Craniopathic Society, a special certification of only 300 chiropractors worldwide. Dr. Dan helps patients from the neck up and the neck down. Dr. Dan accepts most insurance plans. Don't continue to live in pain. Call 813-935-1664. 1664 today. That's 813-935-1664 and get on track to better health.
You're listening to the Half Empty, Half Full radio show on the Tan Talk Radio Network. And now, here's your host, the consumer champion, Laurie Zoock.
Welcome back to the Half Empty, Half Full Talk Radio Show. I'm Laurie Zoock, and I have with me Jim Velazquez, and we've been talking about the dirt. We're talking about real estate investments. We're going to talk about real estate investment fraud, and we were talking about the self-directed IRAs. Now, if you use a self-directed IRA to purchase an investment property, mm-hmm. can you live in that property?
Oh, no.
You can't.
You cannot. That's called self-dealing.
Okay.
And self-directed IRAs have very specific criteria. So no, you can't live in it. You can't get into a self-directed IRA with your wife or, you know, like if your wife has her own IRA, then the two IRAs can partner together. But, you know, your wife, my wife and myself couldn't do it that way. You see,
it's an arm's length type
transaction. It's an arm's length type transaction, very regulated. And if you don't want to get stung by the IRS, you want to do it the right way.
Gotcha.
Definitely, there's some rules and regulations there.
Well, what are, you know, when you see these deals, you're talking about Craigslist, and there are plenty mm-hmm. of legitimate investors mm-hmm. groups. I know in Tampa, you got the Tampa Bay Real Estate Investors Association right. or the Suncoast Real Estate Investment Association, you know, where, of course, you assume most of the people are legitimate, and hopefully they are, and they're doing the right thing. Mm-hmm. But what are some warning signs? If someone's going out to purchase property, anyone can call themselves an investor, correct? They don't necessarily have to be licensed with the state of Florida. Correct. If you're
correct.
Just an investor.
Yeah. Yeah.
So, okay, say I'm going out and I want to purchase an investment property and I want to find an investor to work with. How do I find a good person and what do I look out for?
Well, you just kind of pre-answered that.
Okay.
because there are some very good associations and groups that you can affiliate with to kind of learn and grow in the process of being an investor. From that perspective. Plus, you know, you can also find other people to partner with in these types of associations and groups. So that would be the safest, your safest bet. And usually the leader of the particular group that you're going to get involved with, they usually vet out the people that they allow to come into their group. They typically require the individual that wants to get involved to pay dues. So, you know,
like an association.
Yeah, it's kind of like that. So somebody would have to, you know, they wouldn't be able to pull off a fake out
right.
for too long. You know,
so you know how I check people out? I check people out by Googling their name or
yeah.
company name.
Yeah.
And then I'll put the word fraud, ripoff, or complaint next
up.
To it. And then I see what comes up. And a lot of people don't even think to do that. But yeah. a lot of times it works. Tell you that. Plus, if you check court records, you can also see has that person been plaintiff or defendant in a lot of lawsuits in any of the local counties. So that's kind of how I do it.
Right.
But, you know, I see we're talking about Craigslist, and there are tons of ads on Craigslist, lots of websites from investors. And they offer things like rent to own, lease option, lease purchase, owner financing. Give me an idea. What does that mean?
Wow.
And it, how does it affect the interest rate when you're not going through a bank?
Oh, well, you know, unless you have sterling credit and, you know, your debt to income ratio is on target and so many other things, getting a bank loan now is very, very difficult. If you're self-employed, yeah, it's even another notch and level above difficult. But all of those things that you mentioned are great ways for folks to get into a property, either, you know, to own it themselves as a home or to get it as an investment.
Well, is the price on those houses typically comparable with what you see, you know, per square foot, or are they higher? How does the investor make their money? You know, is it on the interest rates, and what's a reasonable interest rate? How do they determine that if maybe their credit doesn't pass inspection, so to speak?
Well, I'll put my investor hat on now.
Yes, please.
Okay.
Please. We're switching hats.
As an investor, okay, the way that you make money is when you buy the property, not when you sell it. You already have to know your exit strategy when you buy the property.
Okay.
From an investment standpoint.
So give me an example. I'm going to buy a property from you
okay.
as an investor.
Well,
how does it work?
There's something that's called a buyer's list. I have people already on a list that want to buy a particular kind of property.
Right.
Now, the way that happens, if you're an investor, is you have those people coming to you. The probability is bigger, more in numbers wise that, you know, you're going to have an opportunity to do something with that individual. But
okay.
When I buy a house, I buy it from a seller that is motivated to sell it.
Okay.
So if I own that house as an investor, I already bought it at the right
price. So you're going to buy in cash.
So,
and you're getting a good deal.
Sometimes
okay.
I do, but other times I will do an option contract on a property and still am able to get a good enough opportunity to pass it on to somebody else. Now,
okay.
Typically, you will pay a little bit more on interest because the investor is taking a risk.
I mean,
there's a risk factor involved. So, yeah, you're not going to get the same deal that you would get as if you went to a bank and.
But it'll give you the opportunity to get into a home.
But yeah,
you'll have the credit issues.
Exactly.
Now, you know, when you purchase an investment property, does the consumer have the right to inspection and appraisal?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. Yeah. And I would encourage everybody to do that from the standpoint of whether they're buying it for themselves or buying it as an investment. And typically that's in the contract that you would use.
Okay.
It gives you a certain period of time to do an inspection and an appraisal. And then if it's not satisfactory to you, the buyer, then the contract would be void.
Right. And I would think if someone said you don't have the right to have an inspection and appraisal, that would be a big red flag.
Oh, gosh. Yeah. I mean, that, yeah, go
somewhere else.
Go. Yeah, go. Leave the table.
Now, do consumers have other legal rights? And I know, again, that's your legal disclaimer, but do they have other rights as far as inspection, appraisal? Is there anything else that they should have done? How do they know what the comps are on a property that's, you know, that they're going to purchase as either an investment or for themselves?
Well,
how do they know?
The comps are really easy now with internet and computer and everything. I mean, you just go to the Pinellas appraiser site, you go to Hillsborough appraiser site,
right.
and you can pull up a specific address and you can get information as to what the people paid for it, how long they've owned it. It also, you bet, the click of a button will give you comparables in that same neighborhood.
Okay.
The properties that have sold. And that's straight across the board on all the counties that are in our tri-county area. So, yeah, that's an easy way to do it. And certainly if you have a relationship with a realtor or real estate professional, they should be able to pull comps for you off the MLS, multiple listing service. As well as another avenue.
All right. Well, you know, good investments. Let's talk about making wise investments. How does a new real estate investor start? We talked a little bit about, you know, you can find the associations, maybe someone like yourself finding a good mentor. I see all the stuff as far as online courses. You remember the old Carlton Sheets, books, classes, real estate investing associations, you know. It's so convoluted, for lack of a better word. There's so many different ways. So maybe a newbie, I would think online. I'm cautious about when it comes to online, because when you're reading what someone wrote, most people don't consider the source, which is where you have to do your due diligence.
Mm-hmm.
So you could be taking a course from someone who really has absolutely no clue.
Right.
So they need to find either a group or a mentor that can actually explain to them how it really works, maybe, I'm thinking, and give them more personal, you know, guidance.
Yeah, you're right on target with that. I mean, if you're thinking about starting out as an investor, then most definitely educate yourself. That's the first thing. And there are some online courses that are okay. I'm not going to, you know, give out a list of online courses, but you can go to my site, placemybid.com.
Okay. Good plug there, Jim.
But,
that's all right.
But we do have a whole section there on success coaching. And then we also have another section for realtors so that realtors can get educated on how to handle a transaction and a consumer. But
Well, it's different. Realtors tend to handle it one way, investors another.
Totally.
And then you have investors that are realtors, but you don't have as many realtors that are investors.
Right.
Realtors usually stick with, you know, the rigid guidelines, whereas investors tend to go for the more creative and, you know, hopefully usually legal, but not always.
Within the bounds of what is allowed, obviously, and it, and the way that I structure my deals is always a win-win situation. I mean, it's got to be. Right. I mean, if it's not good for you and it's not good for me, then why are we doing it?
Well, you know? Someone like you has a conscience. Remember, there are some people out there.
Some
that
people don't. Of course.
We got a couple of minutes before we go to the next break. But tell me, how are county county and private auctions? I've seen auctions on eBay. Mm-hmm. You know, are those risky? Are you buying sight unseen? I mean, I would think on eBay you might not see the property if you're not buying it, obviously, in your state. But the county auctions, do you know in advance? Can you go look at the property? And I would assume you'd have to, if you're not knowledgeable, maybe bring a general contractor and or an inspector and have an idea. How does that work?
Yes, to what you said there, you can go look at it first. Our county here in Pinellas requires you to register for bidding if you're going to try to buy a house that way. Really, you're not going to get a great deal at an auction. I mean, that's my experience because everybody's there wanting to buy at an auction. So, you know, the best way to make a deal is to have somebody come to you, a motivated seller come to you. But auctions are, there's a lot of them out there. Typically, you have a time, you have to put a pledge of something up in order to just bid on the property.
Cash usually.
Cash. Yeah, it has to be a cashier's check, certified fund, something. They have to have it in their possession before you can actually, you know, be a bidder on the auctions. But, you know, they're not my preference of buying a property.
It sounds to me like it's more the leftover type deals.
I mean, think about it. When you have a lot of people competing, what happens? The price typically goes up. And those homes also always need work. So, you know, there is I think they're much more risky than having an opportunity to have somebody come to you and you have time to check it out.
Right. And we're going to take a short break and we'll be going to be back in just a moment.
Do you suffer from back, neck, or body pain? Do you suffer from migraines or have jaw or face pain? Has conventional medicine failed you? Were you injured or in an accident? Call chiropractic physician Dr. Dan Maddock at 813-935-1664. Dr. Dan has helped thousands of patients gain relief for more than 30 years. Dr. Dan is caring, gentle, and takes his time with each patient. He's also a past president of the International Craniopathic Society, a special certification of only 300 chiropractors worldwide. Dr. Dan helps patients from the neck up and the neck down. Dr. Dan accepts most insurance plans. Don't continue to live in pain. Call 813-935-1664. 1664 today. That's 813-935-1664 and get on track to better health. You're listening to the Half Empty Half Full radio show on the Tan Talk Radio Network. And now, here's your host, the consumer champion, Laurie Zoock.
Welcome back to the Half Empty Half Full Talk Radio Show. I'm Laurie Zoock, and my guest is Jim Velazquez, and we've been talking about real estate investments, you know, how to know whether you're getting a good deal or not. Now, we just talked a little bit about auctions. I also see a lot of advertisements for rehab deals, you know, houses that need to be rehabilitated. And I've seen some of these houses. Some really need to be rehabilitated and or maybe torn down. Right. And then on the other hand, there are some that maybe just need minor, you know, cosmetic work. I'm guessing that these types of deals are more complicated because an investor, which might be a newbie, has to have an idea of the expenses to rehab the property. Mm-hmm. Now, someone like yourself, if you look at a property, you probably already look at the house and say, I can figure out, you know, there's termites. Is it block or wood frame?
Exactly.
You know, you can kind of get an idea of the cost factor, maybe based by on square foot, because you probably have vendors that you work with and you can have done it for a long time. Someone that's new, that's walking in and says, I want to be a real estate investor. Whoa, to do that by yourself? What do you think?
Mm-hmm.
Risky.
Yeah, well, it's interesting that you bring that up. One of the things that I teach is how to get educated on what it's going to cost to do a whole host of different things in a house. And it's really not that complicated. Real quickly, you go to Home Depot. You spend a few hours walking up and down all the aisles, windows, doors, plumbing, electrical, components, okay? You look at what all of these things cost at Home Depot. You write it down. You make a list. So now you have an inventory of all different kind of products.
Then you double it?
No, you don't do that. Because you don't want to do the work. You want to get somebody else to do the work. Trust me on that, okay? Been there, done that. I've done over 2,000 real estate transactions in 36 years. So,
okay.
You know,
that's a lot.
A lot, right? So you don't want to do them yourself, okay? So you have your list, okay? Now you know what it costs to get, you know, a sink, a toilet. You know what I'm saying. You get the idea.
Right.
So now you get on the phone and you call three or four general contractors. And you tell them, just on the phone, you don't even have to have a property yet, okay? You just tell them, hey, look, I want to replace a bathroom, toilet, vanity, tub, tile work, and whatever other projects you want to know about. Kitchens, those are the major components. Roofing, wood rot. Those are the main things you're going to find in a fix-up type house. Flooring, carpeting, tile, all of those kind of things. So you already know what it costs to, you know, material-wise to do that. So now you have professional contractors that are going to tell you, okay, I'll charge you $6,000 to do the bathroom. Okay. Mm-hmm. And those things that you asked me about, right?
Right.
Because it's a pretty set thing. So now you know you have your Home Depot list and you can check off the items. You know it's going to cost you $1,800 to buy these things.
Okay.
Right? So he's making $3,200. Did I do the math right?
I think
whatever,
so.
Something, but you get the point.
Right, right.
You are now getting an education on what the contractor is charging you for his time. Now, the contractor is going to get a little bit better price than you are.
Okay.
On the items.
Because he gets the discount.
They got an account.
Home Depot
loves. They got a contractor account. They have a little bit of a break that they get. It's not a lot, but it's a little bit. So they're making something on the purchase of the items as well. But see how quickly you can get educated on what it costs to do certain things that are the major things that need to be done when you do a renovation.
Right. I think a lot of people think it's a lot less than it actually comes out to.
Always you think it's less. And always it's more.
Right, right. Well, I'm gonna skip ahead a little bit here and kinda go to finding a good mentor. Because I know that you work and have extensive experience as a mentor when it comes to real estate investing. What kind of background? Should someone be looking for someone like you that's diversified in, you know, has real estate background, has marketing background, has all this long time
they should have
background.
Brown eyes, brown hair, and a little goatee.
Okay, I know.
No.
You know, well, tell me, how, you know, when you work with a client, what do you teach them? What's your process?
Well, it depends on how they're coming to me, but certainly, you know, working with a mentor is very important. I mean, comes to mind Tiger Woods, Donald Trump. I mean, those are some big names, big people. They all have coaches. They all have mentors. So it doesn't matter how much you think you know. There's always, I have mentors. So you grow, you learn, you get better. The Bible says metal sharpens metal. Well, you know, it's the same thing. If you're in a mastermind with people that have more experience or knowledge, then you're going to get that.
Right.
There's a saying that says you are the average of the closest five people that you surround yourself with. Think about that.
Right.
Okay. So it's important who you put around you.
Well, I always try to go with smarter people because I'd rather be the least of the smartest people in my group.
That'll
because
bring
then
you
I'm
up.
Learning something.
Exactly.
But if I'm the smartest, then I'm not learning anything.
They're learning off of you. So that's exactly the point.
So you kind
with
of
want to
be, if you're like an average, then you kind of have half above and half below so you can be helped and help others at the same time.
Well,
yeah,
what
like
you'll
that.
Do is go outside of that mastermind group and help others because that's part of your growth as being able to give back. But, you know, it's I cover so many different things. The most important thing in real estate is marketing. So I cover things like, how do you get people, motivated people, to call you?
Okay.
Because isn't it easier if somebody's calling you up saying, hey, help me sell my house?
Than the other way around.
Then you picking up the phone and calling for sale by owner people.
It's like being an ambulance chaser.
Right, exactly. I mean, think about that. So that's one of the main things that I focus on. And then also self-development. You know, how to have the right mindset, how to have the right resources and connections, how to negotiate a deal, how to talk to sellers and buyers.
Because so basically, you're training them to be you.
I basically am. Yeah. I mean, listen, one thing that I always looked for when I was choosing my mentor was, what is their depth of experience? And one thing that I've learned is, listen, you learn so much more from your failures,
yes,
and from your mistakes than you do from your successes. So I want to be with somebody that's been through the trenches. Like a quick deviation here, 2006 to 2008, terrible years in the real estate business.
Right.
Everything went blew up. Way down,
right.
Blew
Bubble
up.
Burst.
Terrible, okay? I own two real estate franchises, two Help You Sell real estate franchises, one here, one in California. I was going back and forth during that crazy time. On top of that, I was going through a devastating divorce. So financially, I've been to the bottom and I've been to the top.
Right.
Okay. So it's much better to be with somebody
that's been at both,
that has experienced that.
I get it.
Because right?
It kind of puts you in the middle. You've seen the worst, you've seen the best. So you're from a position.
So you know
of power
how to get
now.
Out.
All right. So when a mentor assists, does a mentor typically assist their client in doing deals? Like when you work mm-hmm. with somebody, do you help them? I came to you and said, hey, I want to learn how to do this. And we went through training.
Yes.
Now maybe I find some possible deals. But, you know, I would be nervous saying, well, what if I mess up on the paperwork and right. I, you know, hurt myself financially? Is that something that you do?
Yes, absolutely. That is something that we do. Many times I will joint venture with the student and assist in the acquisition and sale of the property that is found. You said something about doing the paperwork, that you're going to screw up the paperwork. Listen, never, ever, ever do a closing without a title company or an attorney.
Because they're double checking everything
They're always. It's going to cost you a few $100, $500. But you know what? It's going to save you thousands of dollars potentially.
Right.
So, and typically the way I structure my deals is the buyer pays that fee anyway.
Okay.
Just like if a bank does it, the bank is not going to pay the attorney. You are.
I gotcha.
Okay. So that's how I teach people. I coach and teach people how to structure the deal properly.
Now, I know realtors have to be licensed in the state of Florida, mm-hmm. but we talked a little earlier. Investors do not, correct?
Do not, no.
Okay. And when you give me an idea of the topics that you cover when you're mentoring somebody, you know, just give me a short, like 1 minute. I start with this, I go to this, and then we end up doing a house.
Well, the first day that I meet somebody, I spend a little bit of time on learning where they're at. Also establishing what their goals are. Where do they want to be? What is it that they're trying to achieve? What's their purpose, their mission? A lot of different
right.
things we talk about as they relate to real estate. We go over contracts. We go over estimation. I gave you a little example of,
right.
of one of the things that I use. We actually call people up and I show them how to handle a phone call, how to call back a seller that's inquired. So we do a pretty hands-on thing. We go out into the field and, you know, we actually look at properties together and evaluate properties together. So
it's like having a partner, really.
Yeah. You know, I don't have my checklist in front of me, but trust me.
Yeah, just to give us an idea.
It's a big checklist. And I do a 3-day very intensive training, but then I also am available for a full 12 months. We do a one-month mastermind so that they have an opportunity to plug in and connect with others just like them and others that are more experienced than them.
And so, they get a chance then to learn. Well, we're gonna take a quick break. We'll be back in just a moment.
Hello, I'm Jim Velazquez. Does getting a lousy 1% on your CDs make you sick to your stomach? Inflation is hovering at 3%, so what's really happening? Allow me, Jim Velazquez, to send you my free report. If you haven't reviewed your CDs in a while, don't get this report. It will break your heart. If you want to fight back and beat the bank, text RETIRE to 72727 for this free report. Let's beat the bank. Text RETIRE to 72727 for your free report.
You're listening to the Half Empty, Half Full radio show on the Tan Talk Radio Network. And now, here's your host, the consumer champion, Laurie Zoock.
Welcome back to the Half Empty, Half Full Talk radio show. My guest is Jim Velazquez, and we've been talking about real estate investments, what to look out for, you know, what's good, the good, the bad, the ugly. And we're going to talk a little bit about, you know, solutions if you've been defrauded. And yes, Jim, I'll give you a disclaimer. You're not an attorney. You're not giving legal advice. This is just general educational conversation here. But, you know, you're right. If you think you discover that you've been defrauded on a real estate transaction, give me examples of where a transaction could be illegal. What are some, you know, I know, like, for example, on our last show, we talked about fraudulent appraisals, for example.
Yep.
But I'll go back to something I mentioned in the very beginning. You know, there are some realtors that will, or investors that will take the, if a homeowner's in trouble, they'll sign the deed over to them, which I understand kind of puts the bank, you know, at a disadvantage. But then they might leave the homeowner stuck with the mortgage and then nothing happens. And now the homeowner is basically, it's a big mess because they don't have the deed anymore.
Right.
It's not titled. Can you talk a little bit about that?
Well, for the homeowner, because that's the example that you just gave.
Yes, for the homeowner.
For the homeowner, they should not do anything like that unless, like I said in the last segment, there is either a title company or an attorney involved. Now, I'm not saying that that's not a potential solution, because it could be. It could do several things to put a cloud on the title to help the seller by way of slowing down the process of getting them out of the house. So it's not, you know, it's not always a bad thing, but it should be done under the guidance and supervision of a legal entity.
A lawyer
or a title company would be able to assist in that type of a counsel. Okay. But my preference, a lawyer.
Okay. And you're not a lawyer. We mentioned
right.
that before, but as far as educational suggestions as to what agency a consumer can go to, you know, maybe before they retain an attorney, if they think, you know, cause obviously you may think you've been defrauded.
Mm-hmm.
We said things may be immoral and unethical, but not necessarily illegal. Some of the ones I thought of were, you know, you can complain to the attorney general,
mm-hmm.
probably if they're a real estate agent, Realtors Board, Consumer mm-hmm. Financial Protection Bureau,
yep.
Florida Bar,
yep.
Better
Your
Business Bureau.
Your local congressman. I mean, there's a, you know, I had a client recently who had a credit issue on,
okay.
on your end of the thing. Actually, I was going to tell you about that. I'll tell
okay,
you now.
Okay, sure.
They told me what they did because this particular individual was also a veteran.
Okay.
So what he did was he called his local congressman's office and he said, hey, I'm a veteran. And this has to do, it had to do with his VA loan.
Okay.
So what he did was he made a complaint to his local congressman and said, you know, this is not my obligation. They're reporting it to my credit incorrectly. And I need some help. I've been trying to deal with this for who knows how long and I'm getting nowhere. And guess what happened?
They helped him.
They helped him. And
right.
And it got resolved. It's off of his credit now.
Yeah,
and I don't know. Came to me.
That's a good point. Sometimes when you complain to the attorney general about something on your credit, They send you a pamphlet in the mail.
Mm.
But when you call your congressman, your senator, your state representative, you have to actually – I tell people sometimes it's a phone call. Sometimes you actually need to make an appointment and go in because you don't want to get a pamphlet in the mail. Mm-hmm. You want someone that can actually help you. So I think that that is a good way. Now, when somebody is looking for – I'm going to backtrack here for a second on the mentors. You know, or actually, no. Let me go back to if you if you've been defrauded, how do you avoid unethical companies? How do you avoid that? Mm. You know, we talked a little bit about Googling. But, you know, as a credit consultant, I hear all kinds of stories about people who were defrauded in real estate transactions. You know, then it cost them. Now they're defrauded, so they have no money. Now you have to tell them to go out and hire a lawyer, which a lot of times they don't qualify for legal aid because the income's too high. Well, so do you see where people kind of get
stuck?
Yeah,
I see that. But, it comes back to the initial thing, you know, before you jump. Get a professional involved so that those kinds of things will be avoided. I think if more people approached it that way, then we would have less fraud and less, you know,
but this is problems. It's funny. When I moved here, I didn't know that this state was called fraudulent Florida. I didn't, coming from the north, I didn't know that. And I know that a lot of people come here and they prey on the elderly, which of course there are laws that are supposed to, strengthen the cases if they find the person that did it. But honestly, I don't see a lot of people going to prison, do you?
No. I mean, unfortunately, no. And you would know more about that than me because
they're not going. I'll tell you.
Area of expertise.
They're not going there. Real estate wholesaling. Give me a definition of what that is.
Simple definition of wholesaling is you would go and capture or contract the property as a wholesaler. And in order for it to work, there's a certain formula that is used to determine whether it's a wholesalable deal or not. And and trust me, people like myself that are investors that are looking for deals like that, we know what a property's worth. So you can't, think you have a deal and it's not a deal. But wholesalers, simply what they do is they go tie up a property. And then they find an end person because if you're wholesaling, you're looking for cash. You're not looking to hold it or rent it, or you don't have the resources to hold it till you can find a buyer. You find an investor that has the money that can close the deal, and you make the difference. Typically, it's somewhere between $3,000 and $5,000 on our average purchase price.
Okay. Now, is that the same thing as when I hear people say, the deal is being assigned? In other words, okay, that's the same thing.
Yes. Similar to that. Yeah. There's different ways to do it, but yes.
All right. Now, I always see the words or the letters ROI, return on investment, right?
You were going to ask me that question.
Yeah. I was going to ask you when it comes to that, what is...
It's good for me.
And is that the same thing as a cap rate? Those are terms I understand return on investment probably tells you the percentage you can expect to get over the course of a year, assuming all things go well. What is a good return on investment? Is it based upon the property, commercial or residential?
If you have your money in the bank, it's 1% or less.
Which is nothing. It's going to be minus soon.
It is minus. Yeah. The rate of inflation is hovering at about 3%. So if you have your money in the bank, you're at a -2. That sounds pretty good, right? That's one of the reasons why I coach and teach and show folks how they can use their IRA to self-direct their money and grow it exponentially, all in a tax protected environment. So it is really growing huge. Listen, I made an example for you. Gains from investments refers to proceeds obtained from selling an investment. So here's the way it works. Let's say that you buy a house for $100,000 and you sell it for $150,000. Do you need me to stop?
No, I'm just talking to the mic.
To the mic. For example, I'm going to do it a different way because I got an example here that's very clear, and I wrote it down for you guys.
Okay.
And another thing I think is great is if you log in to your Facebook site. What is your Facebook
page? Half empty, half full.
Okay. Then what we could do is we could post some of these resources on there for your people.
Great.
So they can kind of look and see what we've been talking about, and they'll be able to see the examples.
Good. I think that's a quick, easy way to do that.
They can just hop into that.
Okay. Exactly.
So if you buy 20 shares of a pizza place for $10 a share, okay, and your investment costs you $200, right? Mm-hmm. So if you sell those shares for $250, then your ROI would be $250, because that's what you sold it for, minus the $200 that you paid for it, divided by the $200 that you paid for it, and
wait,
that
so
would give you
20%. So it's 20%.
It would be, in that case, it would be 25%.
Oh, 25%. Right. I was close.
In that case, it would be 25%. But it's a simple formula. You take the gain from the investment minus the cost of the investment, and you divide it by the cost of the investment.
So I gotcha. Now, I've heard the term cap rate. We've got about a minute left. Is that something that applies in real estate, or am I totally off?
You're totally off. That's
okay,
typically,
good.
You know, commercial type transactions that are bringing in gross revenues. A
right. Because when I look at the return on investment, it says 14%. But does the 14% take into account things like if you have to hire a property manager, if you have to do landscaping, you know,
yeah.
It's minus expenses. Minus expenses. So 14% is actually a good return on investment.
Yeah,
and
I would think so.
The investor is claiming that on the Craigslist ad, but does that mean it really is no, you have to do your due diligence, correct?
You have
correct?
To check it out. Yeah, absolutely.
And you've got to check it out.
Because not everybody includes the taxes and in the insurance and the property manager when they tell you that 14% number. But a reputable person would have all the costs associated with that investment. So then you would know what the true ROI is.
Okay.
You should. But always check it out.
All right. Well, any last tips for us? Anything that you want to talk about? Any wrap up?
Well, we had talked about doing an offer for your listeners.
Sure.
So I'm going to put that out there right now. I don't know if I have that here. Probably not. I'm not going to do it.
Well, we can put it up on the podcast.
We'll put it up on the podcast page. Okay, great. So to get a free report on different, like, safe alternatives to the stock market, let's say that, then you can either do one of two things. You can email me at Jim, or you can go to my website, jimvelazquez.com, and you can get it that way. Or you can pick up your mobile device and you can text RETIRE as the message. And the phone number you would text it to would be 72727. So just message RETIRE to 72727. Or go to my website, jimvelazquez.com. The first five people to do it are going to get a free book.
All right. And last thing, phone number before we close the show.
Phone number 727-935-5652.
Great. Thank you for doing the show with me today. And you can hear previous podcasts by going to the tantalk1340.com podcast page and clicking on the Half Empty, Half Full radio show. Join us every Thursday night at 11 p.m. for a new Half Empty, Half Full Talk radio show. Learn something new every week and get smarter faster. Be safe.
Hello, I'm Jim Velazquez. Does getting a lousy 1% on your CDs make you sick to your stomach? Inflation is hovering at 3%, so what's really happening? Allow me, Jim Velazquez, to send you my free report. If you haven't reviewed your CDs in a while, don't get this report. It will break your heart. If you want to fight back and beat the bank, text RETIRE to 72727 for this free report. Let's beat the bank. Text RETIRE to 72727 for your free report.
Consumers, do you have bad credit? Can't purchase a house or car? Paying too much in interest on your credit cards and loans? Scammed by credit repair companies? There is hope. You can get back on track and do it the right way. Call Credit Education Consultants today at 813-500-6064. That's 813-500-6064. Or go to crediteducationconsultants.com now and get the help you need. Don't delay. Call today. Mortgage reps and realtor inquiries are also welcomed. Do you suffer from back, neck, or body pain? Do you suffer from migraines or have jaw or face pain? Has conventional medicine failed you? Were you injured or in an accident? Call chiropractic physician Dr. Dan Maddock at 813-935-1664. Dr. Dan has helped thousands of patients gain relief for more than 30 years. Dr. Dan is caring, gentle, and takes his time with each patient. He's also a past president of the International Craniopathic Society, a special certification of only 300 chiropractors worldwide. Dr. Dan helps patients from the neck up and the neck down. Dr. Dan accepts most insurance plans. Don't continue to live in pain. Call 813-935-1664. 1664 today. That's 813-935-1664 and get on track to better health.